Good morning, my dear student. This is a third class of the plant protection, the insect pest of rice. So you all know the rice is a staple food for more than 60% of the world population and more than 18.6 million inhabitants of Sri Lanka. The paddy is cultivated in Sri Lanka as in wetland crops. According to the 2019 statistics, the current rice cultivation extent is nearly about 7 million, more than 7 million hectares. So mainly rice is cultivated in two seasons, Maha and Jala season. You all know about that. After the monsoonal started, the farmers are cultivating. In the rice cultivation is being affected by more than 100 insect pests. Among them, 20 are causing economical damages. So due to this insect pest attack, more than 37% of the production is being lost. Therefore, we have to study of these pests to take care of this management of the rice cultivation. Insect pest of paddy or rice. So we can classify it into three different categories: stem borers, leaf feeders, and stasep feeders. Right? So why we are classifying? To easy understanding of how these pests are damaging and where these pests are causing damaging on rice plants. If you are taking the stem borers, there are two categories of stem borers. First is yellow stem borer, right? Scriphophaga insertulus. Other than this yellow stem borer, there are two other stem borers are there. The pinkhead stem borer and white stem borers are there, but they are not causing much problem in Sri Lanka. But yellow stem borer is a very big problem in all of the Sri Lanka. Another stem borer is there, we call it as a gall midge or the gall flies, belongs to Diptera. What a Diptera? Yellow stem borer belongs to Lepidopteran. So this is belongs to Dipteran. We call it as Oriciolia oricea. Right? So these two stem borers are highly economically important pest of rice in Sri Lanka. If you are taking the second group, the leaf feeders. In the leaf feeders, there are more than 9 leaf feeders are there. Among them, the world maggot, leaf folder, and greenhorn caterpillar, and the rice hispa and spine beetle are causing some extent of economic damage in some part of Sri Lanka. The world maggot, we call it as a hall maggot, we call it as a Hydrilla sasaki. So belongs to the maggot, if it is coming as, considering as a maggot, this belongs to Diptera. Swarming caterpillar, Spodoptera moraesia. The one is one of the species of armyworm, right? Spodoptera moraesia belongs to Lepidoptera. Rice ear cutting caterpillar, Methymna separata. This is belongs to another Lepidoptera. And caseworm, Nymphula dipunctalis, another Lepidoptera. Leaf folder. There are two species there in Sri Lanka. There are three species, but two are prominent. Nephelocrosis, he is silent. Nephelocrosis medinalis. Not the spelling is mistake here. Nephelocrosis medinalis. Sometimes it called as a mainsalis. Mainly it be called as a medinalis. And Marasmia petnalis. There are two species are causing damages. The nephelocrosis is a prevalent in all over the rice cultivating areas, especially in the Maha season. Skipper butterflies, some isolated part of Sri Lanka. Pelopoidius matthias. It's called Pelopoidius matthias. The greenhorn caterpillar, Melanthes ledasmin. So you have to familiar with these entomological name for the scientific point of view and your exam point of view, or if you are reading some entomological name, then you can come across with a common name. So you should be familiar with both common and entomological name. Then rice hispa beetle, Decladespa amigera. This is Coleopterans. This is a Coleoptera, right? This is called Coleoptera. And grasshoppers. Grasshoppers are Folifagocyta, also causing these two grasshoppers, Gyrocliphus banian and Oxyanitidula. These two grasshoppers, one is green grasshoppers, Hieroglyphus, another one is short cone grasshopper, Oxyanitidula. These both are causing damages, but not much significant. Not much significant, unless the environmental is shooting them. Another category is there, third category, we call it as subfeeders. Among the subfeeders, rice thrips, the first one, rice thrips, they are damaging at the seedling stage and just before the flowering, at the time of flowering stage. So if the dew is there, flowering time, so you can expect in the dry seasons, that's February, March, it's a very big problem, right? Stenchiato thrips biformis. And brown plant hoppers, Nilapavata lujan. So I told you in the first two classes, this is a very big problem in Ambara district, right? So Ambara is called as a sporadic pest. So Ambara district and some part of Mulathev district. So environment is very cooler. If your plant is very dense, you can expect this pest. Brown plant hopper, Nilapavata lujan, belongs to Hemiptera hoppers. And Rice ear headbug, also the sporadic pest you can expect in few isolated part of Sri Lanka, but commonly this is also the grain feeder, right? They're sucking the sap from the grains, milky stage. The green leaf hoppers, the Nephrotitics nigropictus, Nephrotitics virescens, Nephrotitics impicticeps. These three species, these Nephrotitics nigropictus is prominent, but the problem is they are not causing much economic damage. While they are damaging, they are transmitting the viruses. That's a problem. The zigzag leaf hoppers, time to time, they are causing Resilia dorsalis. And white-back plant hopper, Sogadilla furcifera. The Sogadilla furcifera, rice mealybug, the Brevinia ricci, and another earlier it called as an Saccharicola. So Saccharicola, right? Pseudococcus Saccharicola, but now it has been changed, name has been changed as a Brevinia ricci. So these are, we call it as a subfeeders. These three categories of pest are causing the damage. So among them, we will study first the pests which are important or economically causing tremendous losses in Sri Lanka. The first one, yellow stem borer. Right? So yellow stem borer, so we call it as a Scrophophaga insertulus. Right? Scrophophaga insertulus. Scrophophaga insertulus. Or this is belongs to Lepidoptera. Right, this is belongs to Lepidoptera, so belongs to family Pyralidae. Belongs to family Pyralidae. There are two families are very important. One is Pyralidae, another one is Noctidae. This is belongs to Pyralidae. Why we call this a most destructive pest? Me, this is a host specific. It's me only then they attack rice, not only other crops. The caterpillars alone are destructive. Adults are not causing any damages. Caterpillars are causing the damages. Right? Caterpillars are causing the damages. And how they are causing the damages, especially the larva. Right? Larva. They are boring into the stem. Right? They are boring into the stem and feed inside the stem. It's a hollow stem. You all know the rice plant having the hollow stem. and causing the characteristic symptoms. The specific characteristic symptoms you can expect. There are two characteristic symptoms. This will be described in forthcoming slides too. But the common symptoms, right? So common symptoms, if you are taking, these are the common symptoms, right? So death heart symptoms. So death heart symptoms, we call it as death heart symptom, is an specific symptom of yellow stem borer attack at the vegetative stage. So before flowering, if the incidence is there, definitely you can expect red heart symptoms. And white ear head is after milk stage, or at the time of milk stage, at the time of a booting stage, if stem bored by the larva, definitely you will not get the viable panicle. You will not get viable panicle or head. We call it as a head. That's how you unfeel the chef grinds, chef head, white head. You can expect the white head, the reproductive stage. If attacked at reproductive stage. And the presence of the egg masses near the leaf tips. So egg masses is here. You can find that egg masses. If you are finding that egg masses at the leaf blade, especially leaf blade, the backside, or bending leaf, if there are some bending leaves in the backside, you can expect the leaf masses covered by the tuft hairs by the female for the protections. And activity of this moth, male and female moths, or yellow stem borer moth, if you're identifying, especially you can expect more this moth in the late evenings or early morning. And the frasses or feeding halls. Frasses and feeding holes, if you are finding they are somewhere else, definitely you can find that this attack is there. Right? This attack is there. So these are the characteristic, or these are the symptoms. First two, yeah, dead heart and white ear head. These are the characteristic symptoms. Others are also the symptoms. So you can expect, if you are identifying these symptoms, definitely you can expect that pest in the field. Right? Except that field in the... So identification of the pest, how you can identify, especially eggs. So creamy white eggs, so flattened, oval or scale-like. You can find that eggs will be there here inside this. Right? So inside that, you can find it. These are the eggs. In this eggs, covered by tuft hair, anal part of the female laying hairs, right? So covered by colored hairs, covered with colored hairs. Eggs, you can find that. It's not single, check as a mass. The larva is a pale yellow and dirty white. Larvas, you can find it pale yellowish or dirty white with brown head, with a brown pronotum. Pronotum means just behind the head or very closer to the head. You can find head and pronotum are sometimes different, very difficult to differentiate in early stages of larvas. The mature stage, you can easily differentiate, right? And pupate, the silken cocoon, you can find they will pupate inside the stem. Silken cocoon. Right here, you can find that inside the stem, you can find the cocoons. Right? So adults, so wingspan is nearly about of 25 to 45 millimeter. This is the female one. This is the male one. You can easily differentiate male and female because this female, you can find the characteristic black spots on the forewings. Each side of the forewings, you can find black secular prominent spot. It's a nice special identification characters. And also the females are bright yellowish orange colors than the males. Males are similar compared to the females. Right? Compared to the females. You cannot expect the spots in the females. Males. The females, you can find it. So this is a damage. So once the larva went inside, So they will eat inside and remove the frosts outside. Right? So this is the beauty of these insects. So if you are rearing that one, they will not keep up these frosts. Many insects, more than 85%. Some insects, they will keep their frosts with them to protect from these enemies. But many insects, they will remove that excreta through the hole. So inside that one, you see, these are the feeding tunnels. Larval while feeding. So penetrating and eating inside the stem, whole stem. So if it is inside the whole stem is eaten away, then there is a problem in translocation of the water and nutrition. You can expect that breakage in these regions. And also pupate inside the silken cocoon of the stem. These are the pupa. Right, so pupa here, if you are removing that one, you can find the pupa here. It's called optic type pupa. The male and female differentiation here. This is a life cycle. So life cycle, you can find, you also, you can easily find when you are rearing that larva. So eggs are laid by the female as a group. Right, 2 to 3 group per female. A female can lay 2 to 3 group. And each and every cluster, you can expect 15 to 80 eggs. Sometimes you can expect 100 eggs if the environment is suitable, the food is abundant. Eggs will catch in 5 to 8 days. Means nearly 1 week, eggs will catch out. So neonate, the larva coming out from the fresh egg, we call it as a neonate. Neonate is a purely white. Right? Purely white means a pale white, dull white, black. The dull white color, and it will not, so this is will get down from the leaves by producing silken thread. You see, silken thread, the larva will produce a silken thread. Through this silken thread, so definitely they will get down from the leaves because eggs laid in the leaf plates, so they have to go inside the stem, so they have to get down. What they will do, they will produce silken thread and get down, and sometimes it will fall on the water. Right? Water and float in the water. Right? Get blown off. So, and the water and swimming freely and get into the plant. Right? Water swimming freely and get into the plant. So, if the internal first attack will be, you can find that in between the leaf sheath and the knots joining region, internodes, they will penetrate right near the nodal region, right, and go in. So, the neonate, in first few hours after catching, get down and reach the nodal region and start to feed external epidermis of the stem, and it will go inside. And start to feeding further, and it will be there until the pupation. Will be there inside until the pupation. Another pest is there. So another pest is there. So with the white stem borer, Scrophophaga innotata. Scrophophaga insertulus yellow stem borer. Scrophophaga innotata is a white borer. This is not much causing the problem, but some extent compared to other pink head borer, black head borer. So this yellow stem borer is the first one causing economically damages. And white stem borer, you can expect some high areas, not dry zones, intermediate zones, the wetland rice myrtle areas, you can expect a few. So nature of the damage, yellow stem borer's nature of the damage, I told you in the vegetative stage, larva feeding the green leaf tissues. Larva feeding green leaf tissues, that's how you can expect, right, green leaf tissues on the leaf sheath in 2 to 3 days. The bore into the stem and causing, so that's the damage you can expect. So the damage you can expect there by the larva. So this is, we call it as death heart symptoms. This is we call it as a dead heart symptoms. And the heading stage, if it is reproductive stage damage, you can expect that white head. The dead heart, white heart are specific symptoms of gelosim. White heart is sometimes it may confuse, right? Some other insect or some of the diseases can also causing the white head. But if the white head is, if the gelosim attack is there, you can expect white. That's the things we call it as a characteristic. So if the reproductive stage, if damage occurred, definitely you will lose your production. There is no panicle, no grain. So then severe yield losses you can expect. So that's how you have to be very careful at the booting stage or the panicle initiation stage. If the damages or if the larva or if the adults there or not. You can monitor by using the setting up light traps. Light traps in the late evenings, definitely if you are monitoring that gelosim borer females are there here and there, then definitely you can go for an easy management. If it is there, not there, then no, don't worry about that. Second borer, we call it as a rice gall mitch. Right? So this is we call it as an Oriciolia oricei. Order diptera, family Cecidomidae. Order diptera, family Cecidomidae. This is a diptera like a mosquito. Some people may confuse with a mosquito. This is the one cause severe damages in the last season in Manar districts. Right? It is commonly you can expect in the wetland areas, the cool places, or highland rice cultivation, you can expect more amount of attack of this rice gall mitch, not in the dry zones of Sri Lanka. Right? Dry zones of Sri Lanka. So the eggs, especially you all know that a flat lays egg as a group, but this group is scattered one. So you can consider sometimes individually, sometimes eggs are arranged in a sequence. Right? So fly lay elongated, cylindrical, shiny white, or red to pinkish egg as a cluster, 2 to 6. Right? At the base of the leaf, leaf bases, they are laying eggs, the females, like a mosquitoes. So, and larva is a maggot. It's because it's a diptera, no? You can expect the young one, we call it as a maggot, because these are legless. It's a 1 millimeter long after the catching. It's a very minute, it's very difficult. It will creep down the sheath. Right from the leaf blade, eggs laid leaf blade, so then it will they will crawl or creep, right, by moving, and it will go into the sheath, right, the sheath in between the sheath and stem attacking region, closer to the growing butt, right, closer to the growing butt, the terminal shoot portion, and making oval chamber. Right? While they are penetrating and eating, they will produce saliva. These salivas making this become a chamber or swelling around the feeding sites. So pupa is a, you all know about the maggot, wriggler. So wriggles or barrel pupa, we call it as a barrel pupa. So barrel pupa, you can expect that attached with the stem, not in the soil, because in the paddy field you can expect the water always. That's of the attached with the stem or the in between the leaf sheath and knot. Inside you can expect the pupa, barrel pupa. Adult flies, mosquito likes, you can expect the one pair of wing. The reddish abdomen is an special indicators. That's what the many people are confusing, whether it is a blood-sucked mosquitoes. Blood-sucked mosquitoes also reddish color, no? That's how their farmers and other people are very confused. So the common, I told you, I explained that, but in the rain-fed wetlands, these areas, and causing 30 to 40%, right? 40% of damage. So because the chemical containing saliva producing the hollow cavity, these hollow cavity making that shoots become a gall-like appearances. So if the gall-like appearances, it means that So they are, the plants will not grow further. The plant will not grow further. So that's how you can expect. This is a stem, right? This is a hollow stem. You can find the hollow stem. Inside the hollow stem, you can see terminal shoot. So pupa, the larva and pupa will be there here. And the rice will become a very shiny standard, right? Very shiny and shunted. That's how, so this is, we call it as, right? This is, we call it as, so grass stunting, stunting of the plant possible, right? Stunting of the plant possible. So this is, this population is built up by this environmental condition. If favors, then population will become cloudy and rainy weather. This is most suitable in highland, right? And high tillering varieties in dense population. That's what I told you, you have to maintain optimum density of the plant. The plant is very dense, then there are more chances of the these mosquito-like flies to lay eggs. The intensive management, high nitrogen application favor the buildup, because if they are sucking nose, the plant will be bushy. So this easily, the low parasitization. Parasitization is very low because biocontrol agents will you cannot find, because these larva immediately penetrate and go in the side. Inside, the parasitoid will not go. It's very difficult. Therefore, low parasitization. In Sri Lanka, there are two biotypes of these pests are there. Two biotypes mean some will attack some varieties, some will not attack some varieties. There's a two type of biotypes are there. So these biotypes, according to the biotype availability, only you have to choose the variety. That's a very difficult if the biotypes developed. All the resistant varieties you will not cultivate, because if the two biotypes are present, both are present, then it's half will be damaged, half will not be damaged. It's very difficult. Then therefore you have to monitor it and easily properly identify before the selection of varieties for the management of this. So overall of this pest, I will take management aspect at last, right? So I am just explaining characteristics, symptoms, life cycle of these pests, not management. Management I will take as a indicated. The another one is the first sap feeders, we call it as a rice wool maggot. We call it as a wool maggot, Hydrilla sesagi. This is also another diptera, but the fly shape is different between this one. This is one like a house fly, right? House fly, that's one like a look like a mosquito, goldfinch. But the immature stage is similar, right? Maggots. See, ephridrae. So this one is a Cecidomidae, right? This is, we call it as a Cecidomidae. This one we call it as an ephridrae. Ephridrae, right? Ephridrae. There are two diptera, two families, one order diptera. Hydrilla sesagi. So eggs, white and sugar-shaped eggs laid singly. That one is as a cluster, both earlier stem borers, they are both stem borers, they are laying eggs as a clusters. This one lay eggs individually and sugar shape. It's a curvy shaped eggs, right? Curvy shaped eggs you can find. From that one, so newly catched larva is a maggot. It's a transparent, legless one. So they will move down leaf into the hole of film dew. They need thin film of water for the movement, like a nematode, their droplets. If they are trapped by the droplets, and easily they will go and scrubbing outside the leaves, and they feed the mesophylls. They are scrubbing and eating the mesophyll layers. Right? So that's how you can find the scrub markings and yellowish lesion at the edge. Right? Yellowish lesion at the edge. The pupations take place in between the leaf sheath and pupa, loosely attached to the stem. I told you these two dipterans will not pupate inside the soil. Normally, all the dipterans are pupate inside the soil, but this rice-specific dipterans pupate close associated with the leaf sheath or stem of the rice plants. Characteristic symptoms, you can find the maggot feet, tender tissues inside the hole, longitudinal markings. and shrivel planted if it is damaged severe, and drooping of leaves because it's scrapped, and there is some young leaves, the green ones are eaten away, then your yield of photosynthetic will be less. Photosynthesis will be less than you can expect this yield losses. So you can differentiate this attack from this hydrilla stem borer. This symptom is look like a silver shoot or grass. The onion plants, like they see rice plants, is look like an onion plant. We call it as a silver shoot. It's a specific characteristic symptom of this gall midge attack. But this is the both diphtheria, but this is, you can, they are scrubbing and eating. They are scrubbing and eating. You see, scrubbing and eating white markings. But it will be confusing with a leaf folder. We will study later. Leaf folders also scrubbing and eating, but the easily you can differentiate. Leaf folders are folding the leaves, and inside it will be there. But this is not like this, right? So yellow spots and streaking of leaves are characteristic symptoms of rice wool maggot. Another one is there, the swarming caterpillars or armyworm. We call it Spodoptera moraesia. Spodoptera moraesia is a foliophagous one, but this is not much problematic in Sri Lanka, but sometimes it can cause the damages at the seed nurseries, seedling nurseries, and early stages of the plant. If they are eating earlier, so you can find this is if egg masses, female moths. This is a female moth, right? Female moth lays an egg as a mass, rose, right? Rose, and covered with an white tuft hairs. The anal region of the female moth. I already explained that yellow stem borer too. Yeah, anal region, they have these tuft hairs. These tuft hairs of the females will help to protect their eggs. This is both. Yellow stem borer also covering the eggs. This Podoptera also covering the eggs. If the eggs is covered, predators cannot identify. It's very difficult now if it is covered with the hair. And also, this is when allergic hairs. Third one, this is giving a conducive, protective from the high heats. That's how immediately after the catching, you can find these caterpillars as a cluster. Right? Caterpillars as a cluster. The advantages of this egg masses of the egg masses, laying eggs as an egg masses, for the early management, if you are scouting the eggs, removing the egg masses and burning, you can easily omit the pest. Go into the main field and getting damaged because so young one larvas are damaging, right? So this is go for a six. This larva is going for a caterpillars are going for a series of six molting stages, and it will become a very brownish caterpillars. So we call it as a Spodoptera, also full swarming caterpillar or armyworm. Why it is? So, because if they are catching so many egg masses, caterpillars initially it will be in the congregate form, groups. These groups, while eating, they will move from one field to another, migration, as an army, like battalion. That's what we call it as an army worm. Earlier, it is a greenish caterpillar with the black head, and the while they are molting and in insta development, for each and every insta, the color will be changing. You can find it from the pale green to dark green with the black strips on the dorsal region. Then it will become a brownish one, right? It's a brownish one. So this is a sixth insta larva, nearly about 35 to 40 millimeter. 3 to 4 centimeter, you can expect that larva, bigger one. Then it will pupate. It's a nocturnal, no? They will pupate in the earthen cocoon. Earthen cocoon. So inside the soil, they will pupate. So where do this pest you can expect more is if the water is not present or the dry condition, you can expect more. Why? So they want to pupate, no? Though while the adults are brownish adults, right? Blood is in the wing also, you can find it is like a military cloth. Right? It's like a military cloth. sometimes greenish, sometimes brownish, different, right? So this one, this damage of this pest is earlier caterpillars nibble, right? It means just eating by scrubbing the leaves. While they are becoming larger, while molting, they are voracious feeders. Initially, they will eat as a group. Again, then segregate. And individually, they will eat all the leaves. Voracious feeders, heavy feeder. So, in the seedling stage, eat the whole leaves, including mid-ribs. Sometimes only mid-ribs you can expect. It look like the grass, the cattle grazed appearance. The field of your paddy field is look like a cattle grazed appearance. So, but this is not a frequent pest. Sometimes you can expect. So normally they will move from one field to another during the nights. Caterpillars will move in the night and then eat in the early mornings and the nights. And definitely that it will cause severe doses, like the locust nowadays causing the problem, like this armyworm. But it's not a much big problem in Sri Lanka. In other part of Sri Lanka, other part of the world, you can expect more, especially in India, southern India, but not much in here. So another one is there. Another one is leaf eat feeders. We call it as an leaf folder. Nephlocrosis medinalis. We call it as a Nephlocrosis medinalis. This Nephlocrosis medinalis, or sometimes another species are the Marasmia paternalis. These two, we call it as a leaf folder because they are folding the leaf and eating the leaves. Right? They are folding the leaves. Inside the fold, inside the folds, larva will scrub and eat. Right? So normally, you can find an eggs. Right? Eggs as a few groups or sometimes individually. So this from the larva, initial larva is scrubbing and eating. After the first two molting, then they will make the leaf as a fold while folding and eat. While they are eating, in between the fold, you can find eaten material as well as a black frases. Here, black frases also you can expect. And also pupate inside the leaf fold by making a silken cocoons. This is Fyrallidae, no? Not earthen cocoon, it will not produce Fyrallidae. Silken cocoon, you can find the brownish color pupa, and adult will emerge as a moth. These are weaker flies. Spodoptera is a strong flyer. Yellow stem borer and this leaf folder is a bit weak flyers. Right? It will move. But so the problem is, so they can multiply in the weeds alongside the rice field. That's the problem. So if you are seeing that, this is the light greenish color. With the orangish color head and with the pronotum. Right? Pronotum. So this is a description of eggs are flat, oval shape and yellowish white in color. That's how it is explained here. Oval shape, yellowish white is color. Means sometimes we call it as a transparent. Earlier it will become transparent and later part it will become a brownish or yellowish brown. So mean if this is going to catch. So the larva is greenish translucent. So mean like a transparent. It's a bit translucent. Right? So and also oranges get there. So moths are the pupae are brownish one. And adults are moths are brownish with many dark wave lines. This is an identification correct. Dark wave lines, you can find the three. Wavy lines is a special identification character of this adult. Right? Special identification of this adult. So, this is and also band at the margin of the wing. This is special identification character of this adult. Wavy margins, the dark brownish adult is a leaf folder. So, how they are eating is folding the leaves and eating. Damaged leaf folder, you see that her larva producing the saliva and making into silken thread. And while moving their head here and here, in between the edges of the leaves, they will fold it, right? While moving here to here, and again, bit, leaf will be fold. Inside the fold, you can find the lava, translucent lava, and eating by scrubbing the green content. This is a leaf fold, you see? The saliva make it leave as a fold. Scrubbing and eating marks. So green matter content is eaten away. Therefore, this will interfere with photosynthesis. So severe damages can cause the yield losses. Otherwise, it will not be a problem. You can expect this pest immediately after the heavy rain. Right? Heavy rain. So the heavy use of fertilizer, high humidity and shade help for the multiplication. I already explained that grassy weeds, the field surrounding. Right? So that's why you have to remove all the grasses in the paddy field. Echinocolaba colanum, right? Fennicum repens, maximum, Cyperus rotundus, those are the grasses, right? So you have to remove it. Otherwise, in the off season, they will breed, but the main cropping season, they will move from that herb, the harbor horse weeds to the main crops. The old growth stages of the rice will be attacked. The main yield loss you can expect if they are folding and eating flag leaves. That is a problem, right? So caterpillars can eat any leaves. If the fold leaf, you all know about that the flag leaf is giving the 50% of the yield of the rice. The flag leaf is only single leaf, right? It's an angle. It is present in a 45 degree angle to the sun. That's how they can trap more amount of light. If it is folded, right? If it is folded, then trap light interception areas will be less. Then you can expect more yield losses if flag leaf attacked. Half of the flag leaf and next two young leaves is eaten away by the caterpillars, then photosynthetic yield will be less. Then grain yield will be less. You cannot expect much tillers, right? That is the problem. But you can expect the tillers if the yellow stem borer attacked in the young stages. Young stages, if it is attacked, the main tiller will be killed or sometimes will die. If it is main tiller die, it will promote the primary, secondary, tertiary tillers. It may be an added advantage, but it is not advisable. So the adult moths are nocturnal. So early, late evening, if you are going there in the paddy field, late evening, the females, flying of females, you can expect. They are weak flyers now from the 50 centimeter to 1 meter above the field, ground level. You can find movement of these adults from these weeds into the main field. Right, weed from the weed area, because it's hiding point from the paddy field at the dawn. Right, it's mean late evening to lay eggs. Lay eggs. So this is the damages and life cycle of the leaf folder. Symptoms. So this you can expect the white membranous folded leaves. White scrubbed marking of the leaves and fecal pellets in between the when you open the leaf fold. These are the symptoms. So this is the end of the first section. So if you want to ask any question, so we will continue. So the next pest is a green corn caterpillar. The greenhorn caterpillar is also belongs to Lepidoptera family Satyridae. Right, earlier we were discussing there are two Lepidoptera belongs to two families, Phyralidae and Noctidae. This one is belongs to Satyridae. Satyridae means the wing, right? This wing is something different, right? Wing is something different. So this is butterflies, not the moth, right? This is butterfly. Adults are butterflies, not the moth. We call it as an Melantes ledasmi. The female is a brownish color females, right? You all know the butterflies. Definitely you can expect, you would have seen this one in the your orchard or in your home at the night, right? This is one. You can find the prominent conspicuous black spot and circle with the yellow marking is an threaten, right? Is to escape from the predators and enemies, right? So yellow black color markings here, you can find this is an identification character of the butterflies. It's adult butterflies, nearly you can about 40 millimeter, right? 40 to 60 millimeter wingspan. Right, 40 millimeter to 60 millimeter wingspan. You can find adult. This is a butterfly. The female lays egg in the leaf blade individually. Females lay eggs individually. These are like a pearl, sago pearl, transparent. So from these eggs, nearly you can expect the young ones, neonate, 8 to 10 days. These young ones are very greenish, velvety caterpillar. Right? Velvety caterpillar. The early in stage, you cannot expect the horns. So neonate, you cannot expect the horn. But you can expect the greenish, velvety caterpillar. Very sluggish caterpillar. They will scrub and eat. Right? They will scrub an epidermis and eat. While they are molting and it will grow, nearly 4 molt stages, this larva, so nearly about 40 to 60 millimeter, long caterpillars, very sluggy. And also in the leg, the head is like perpendicular to the body. It's a greenish head. And in the head, you can find 2 horns. That's how we call it as a green horn caterpillar. 2 horns. Sometimes this horns will become a reddish color. In some caterpillars, you can expect this horn is like a greenish color. Right? In some caterpillars, you cannot expect much developed horns because this is to threaten their enemies. Right? Enemies. Very sluggish caterpillar. So this caterpillar, once it is will become a bud, the later stage of a caterpillar, they will eat the leaf blades. Right, they will eat the leaf blades and pupate very closer to the stem. The pupa is a chrysalis because it's a butterfly, you know. It's a chrysalis type pupa you can expect. This pupa also greenish color. Right, greenish color, right, like a translucent in the early stage. And later, it will become a light brownish color once the fully developed adult inside the pupal case, the adult will emerge. So from the larval stage, it will nearly 40 days from the egg to larva to become a pupa, it will take nearly a 1 month time. Right? So depend on the temperature. So nearly sometimes it can go from the pupa up to two weeks to 1 day, 30 days. Temperature and become an adult. These adults are fruit feeders, not fruit feeders. They will come to the orchard to suck the fruit saps on the fallen fruits. It will not damage the fruit in the trees. Fallen fruits, ripened fruit, damaged fruits are there. It will come in the late, right? Adult will be jump and sit and jump. So there are strong flyers. Jump and sit, fly, jump and fly like that. It will go. Right, so you could have seen that one in your orchard. You have seen. So this is the Melantes ledasmi. This is also not causing much yield losses in Sri Lanka. This is also not much causing yield losses in Sri Lanka. Another one is the skipper butterflies. Right, skipper butterflies. So you would have confused with the larva of skipper butterflies and Melantes ledasmi. This Melantes, you can expect that velvety, dense, light greenish hair will be there. But in his skipper butterfly, you cannot expect any hairs. You cannot expect any hairs but the head is look like the greenhorn caterpillar, but you cannot expect the horn. It's a velvety green, this one, greenhorn caterpillar. This one is a dark green. Here also, moth butterfly, skipper butterfly also. This butterfly is very small compared to the greenhorn caterpillar. So it's nearly, this one is a 60 millimeter wingspan. This is nearly 25 to 30 millimeter. Why we are calling skipper butterfly? Mean this butterfly will not fly continuously. Jump, shit, jump, shit, jump. If you're going there in the field, skipping, right? Skipping, this butterfly will not fly. Skip and sit like that, right? So this is, that's what we call a skipper butterfly. This butterfly antenna is something different. And the, in between the antenna, you can find the hooks, right? Hook, you can, so the antennal modification is not capitate or not bipectinate. This is like a something different. You can find it. It's a hook-like structures in between there. It's an identification character of butterflies. The skipper butterfly females, right, normally lays eggs in the daytime. These butterflies are laying eggs in the daytimes. Early mornings, you can expect before hot, it will lay eggs asynchronously. This is also spherical shape and dull white eggs, simply. From this one, so lava will come out. These lavas, early insta lava like Melanotis scrub and neat, and later insta, it's the same like damage symptoms you can expect like greenhorn caterpillar. It will eat leaf blades, not allow only the rim, the midrib will be there in the leaves. Not a voracious feeder, but it will make damages. This is also very sluggish caterpillar, right? And pupate, so chrysalis type pupa in the stem, right here, right? Very close adherence, the long shape, right? Not the short shape like this one. It's a long shape. Chrysalis type pupa hang from the stem or leaf sheets. So adult will come out. Here you can find the hook-like structures in the antenna. This is a Phelopoidus. This is also not causing much economic damages in Sri Lanka. Much economic damages, economically important damages in Sri Lanka. This is a skipper butterfly. This is also leaf feeders. Only young ones are causing the damage. Adults are not causing the damage. Another one is the rice caseworm. Right? Another one is there, we call it as a rice caseworm. Nymphula dipunctalis. This is also belongs to Phyrallidae. This is not an economic important pest in considering Sri Lanka, but in few occasional cases only you can expect, but damages are less. But if it is attacked, economic damages will be high because so the young ones are making, right, young ones are making the case, folding the leaf, cutting the leaves, making the face. Therefore, the photosynthesis will be interfered, severe yield losses. Females are weak flyers, right? Females are weak flyers, whitish color moths, and you can expect the brown conspicuous black spots on the forewings. Females lays eggs, transparent eggs will be deposited as a cluster in a scale. Right, the stem or the leaf blade, you can expect eggs, so more than 100 and 120 eggs as a cluster. From this one, lava will be rise. The lavas, initial stage lava, so will produce silken threads. So a silken thread, and it will go to reach the other plant, and also they will float on the water. They have the gills. The specific characters mean they have the gills for respiration. They are cutting the leaves and making the leaves into case. Like other case, you would have seen that ornamental plants. Inside the case, body of the caterpillar, you cannot expect. It will be there inside the case. Only the head and thorax will be like this, move. Right? Only head and thorax with the case, it will move very slowly. intermittently come out and scrub and eat, and it will go. It will stick the leaves and hang. I stick in the leaf and it will hang. I am stopping here with